Mighty light of the gospel on the source of our problems and the only solution. Please keep Scriptures for America in your prayers. And now, Pastor Peters.
This is part four of The Law, continuation of our series. In the last message, I talked about some of the reasons that people believe today that God's divine law, the law, statutes, and judgments, are no longer in effect. One of the reasons I did not address, and I think I will at the beginning of this message, and that is the plot to destroy Christianity. I would to God that people had enough saddle sense to recognize that someone wants Christianity destroyed. And the Judaizers are doing a very good job of it in regards to this issue of the divine law. Speaking of Judaizers, let's look at Matthew chapter 13, verse 33. The kingdom of heaven is like leaven, which a woman took and hid in three pecks of meal until it was all leavened. I don't want to spend a lot of time talking about the parable here. We can do that some other time, and I think we've done it on other tapes. But notice that he is giving us some understanding concerning his kingdom. It's going to be leavened. Leaven is not something represented in the Bible as good. It's something bad. To prove that, turn over to Matthew 16, verse 6. And Jesus said to them, "Watch out and beware of the leaven of the Pharisees and the Sadducees." Dropping down to verse 11. "How is it that you do not understand that I did not speak to you concerning bread, but beware of the leaven of the Pharisees and the Sadducees?" Then they understood that he did not say to beware of the leaven of bread, but of the teaching of the Pharisees and the Sadducees. Today, the average so-called Christian is not even aware of the teaching of the Sadducees and the Pharisees and how it affects our society today. Turn to Matthew chapter 15, verse 6. "He is not to honor his father and mother, and thus you invalidate the word of God for the sake of your tradition." One of the characteristics of the leaven of the Pharisees was to invalidate the word of God by their traditions. To invalidate means to void or to make of none effect. The word tradition, by the way, is number 3862 in Strong's, and it means handing down or over. Now, we don't call it that today, tradition. What do we call it, this handing down to the next group? We call it case law. Rules of the court, precedents, so-and-so versus so-and-so. We've been more inundated with the Phariseeism than what we really realize. They would rather have their tradition than the law of God. And you'll find that goes on in our courts today. Don't bring the law of God into this court, but they'll listen to so-and-so versus so-and-so, the traditions. But as you analyze the Pharisees of that day, they made of none effect the law of God, the word of God. They held strongly to their traditions. They maintained an air of religiosity. And another thing about these people, if you turn over to Acts 17, verse 6 and 7, that's interesting. They wouldn't obey God's law. They did away with it in their own way. But guess whose law they were more than willing to obey? We read in verse 6 and 7 of Acts 17. "And when they did not find them, they began dragging Jason and some brethren before the city authorities, shouting, 'These men who have upset the whole world have come here also, and Jason has welcomed them. And they all act contrary to the decrees of Caesar, saying there is another king, Jesus.'" The Pharisee and the leaven of the Pharisee is such that they were not about to have Jesus as king ruling over them. And we have that today. They might call him king, but when you say, "All right, if he's king, let's let him rule as king and implement his law, statutes, and judgments," they say, "Hold it. We can't do that. We must obey who?" Caesar. The leaven of the Pharisees. It's amongst us today. And they do this air of religiosity well. Turn to Philippians chapter 3, We read in verse 2 and 3. Beware of the dogs. Beware of the evil workers. Beware of the false circumcision. For we are the true circumcision, who worship in the Spirit of God and glory in Christ Jesus, and put no confidence in the flesh. But we are not aware of the dogs. We're not aware of the leaven of the Pharisees. Now, to go on in this message, I'll say that after listening to part 3, partially myself, I was not very pleased with it. I felt like I spoke too fast, put too much material in at one time, and I'm afraid that I left some people confused. So I'm going to go back over some of the same ground that I covered in part 3, but we're going to go in a different direction as far as plowing, and we're going to use a different tractor, again, to bring out the truths and the points that we need to understand. Understand, if you will, that we're dealing with centuries, well, I should say, we're dealing with generations of false teaching concerning God's law. And you can't clear it all up in just one session. And when you do begin to clear certain things up, questions begin to pop up in your mind. I hope before this series is over with that I'll have addressed those questions, such as, well, didn't Jesus forgive if a person does this rather than implement the law, and so forth. I think, God willing, in the next message we'll talk about the vertical relationship that we have and the horizontal relationship that we have. And when you begin to understand those two, you'll understand better concerning the law, statutes, and judgments being enforced today, and harmonizing that with the fact that Christ can forgive the sinner. Let's begin by reviewing Galatians chapter 3. We spent most of our time in the last message in this chapter. In Galatians chapter 3, I want us to read, first of all, verse 19. Why the law then? It was added because of transgressions, having been ordained through angels by the agency of a mediator until the seed should come to whom the promise had been made. Dropping on down to verse 23. But before faith came, we were kept in custody under the law, being shut up to the faith which was later to be revealed. Therefore the law has become our tutor to lead us to Christ, that we may be justified by faith. But now that faith has come, we are no longer under a tutor. What I decided to do in this message is to show you a new chart, or if you will, an addition to the chart that we had in the previous message. Now, this chart will go out on our tape ministry to accompany this particular message. It shows the dispensations. I think we showed the dispensational teaching in part one of this series. In this case, however, we've got an addition to the chart. Let's review it briefly. As we said in part one of the series, you can divide the Bible up in viewing it in a dispensational fashion. The patriarchal dispensation, where the patriarchs were receiving information from God, and God dealt with the patriarchs such as Noah, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. And the patriarchal dispensation goes up through the time, or up to the time, of Mount Sinai, recognizing the mountains there as Mount Sinai, at which time we have the implementation of the Mosaic dispensation. The Mosaic dispensation going from Mount Sinai to the time of the cross, and there, from the cross onward, we have the Christian dispensation. We covered this chart in more detail in part one. Notice we show the Bible divided in two main groups as far as people viewing it, and that is the Old Testament and the New Testament. Now, what I added to this chart is the heavy dark line underneath it, pointed at each end, showing that it runs from the patriarchal dispensation through the Mosaic dispensation, clear through and continuing on into the Christian dispensation. And in this particular heavy line box, we have God's divine law, His law, statutes, and judgments. Now, I show this in relation to the dispensations. We see that God's divine law existed at the time of the Mosaic dispensation. That most people will not argue. All you need to do is read Leviticus or Deuteronomy, and you'll see that we had laws in there concerning kidnapping, we had laws concerning bestiality, we had laws concerning adultery, homosexuality. And when I say law, statutes, and judgments, maybe I need at this point in time to clarify something, because some people won't understand what it means when I say law, statutes, and judgments. For example, the law, thou shalt not murder. It is not thou shalt not kill, it was thou shalt not murder. Now, that was the law. What was the statutes? Well, we recognize today that there are various types of murder. We have first-degree murder, second-degree murder, manslaughter. And so the statutes fit the type of offense that took place under that violated law. The judgment then was attached to that particular statute. In our society today, a person that commits first-degree murder is treated with a different judgment than a person that commits manslaughter. Isn't that true? And so it was with the law, statutes, and judgments. A person that committed first-degree murder, the judgment was, he shall forfeit his life. A person that committed accidental manslaughter, the judgment was banishment to a city of refuge. That was the judgment. So that's what I mean by the law, statutes, and judgments. And no one questions that the law, statutes, and judgments existed during this Mosaic dispensation. And in part one of this series, we showed how God's laws also existed in the patriarchal dispensation. And what I wrote here, just as a way of reference, is Genesis 26, verse 5, where it says that Abraham kept his law, statutes. And I forget, there's a different word than judgments there. Now, when we come over to the Christian dispensation, because we have been programmed in such a way, it's hard for us to imagine that that same divine law exists. But it does. I wrote here, Matthew 5:17, Christ said, "Think not that I came to destroy the law." I also wrote here 1 Corinthians 6:9, where Paul is teaching that neither fornicators or adulterers or homosexuals shall inherit the kingdom. What we don't recognize from that teaching is, why will they not inherit the kingdom? Because the law that's still in effect in Christ's kingdom is, you can't do those things. It still is in existence. Let's look at Romans chapter 2, verse 12. For all who have sinned without the law will also perish without the law, and all who have sinned under the law will be judged by the law. For not the hearers of the law are just before God, but the doers of the law will be just. And so what I want to have here then is Romans chapter 2, verse 13. There we see that it's the doers of the law that shall be just. Now, if you're a little confused because of a teaching in Galatians that we read in the last message, bear with me. But that is just a proof text to show that the law was still in existence even at the time of the writing of Romans. What law was he talking about? The Mosaic Law Covenant? No. Look at the context. Over here he says in verse 22. Let's look at verse 21. You who preach that one should not steal, do you steal? The problem he was having was with these Judaizers. They were trying to maintain the law, but they were violating the law all the time. And he says, you say that one should not commit adultery. Do you commit adultery? The context shows that Romans 2:13 is dealing with God's divine law. Adultery, stealing, that type of thing. You with me? Lastly, I wrote here, John chapter 8, verse 7. I think this is an important passage. Let's turn there. Because this passage not only teaches that God's divine law is in effect, but that God's divine law with its statutes and judgments are still in existence in the Christian dispensation. Now, I think, God willing, I might bring a whole sermon on this particular event, but for now we'll just look at one part of it, and that's verse 7. The woman taken in adultery, brought before Christ. But when they persisted in asking him, he straightened up and said to them, "He who is without sin among you, let him be first to throw a stone at her." Now, the Judeo-Christian world would use this to do away with God's law, saying, see there was a woman taken in adultery, brought by these men before Christ. The law of God said that a person that committed adultery, the judgment was what? Death by stoning. But Jesus said, let him that is without sin cast the first stone. What we miss here, and like I said, it takes a little discipline not to get off on a whole sermon on this one, by the way. But like I said, we'll get that some other time as a message maybe, but Christ was showing us that the law was in effect. The point we miss is he said, stone her. Didn't he? When you boil it down, he says, go ahead, stone her. Why? That was the law of God. Now they didn't, and like I said, this is a whole separate message. They were trying to trap him. And we'll talk about why she wasn't stoned and didn't have to be stoned in another message. But the point is, God's word shows that Christ understood that the law, statutes, and judgments were existed in this time also. Let's go back to Romans chapter 2, verse 13, and read that again. For not the hearers of the law are just before God, but the doers of the law shall be justified. Whoa, someone says. Now that sounds just the opposite of what Paul said in Galatians chapter 2, verse 16. Let's turn there. Nevertheless, knowing that a man is not justified by the works of the law, but through faith in Jesus Christ, even we have believed in Christ Jesus, that we may be justified by faith in Christ and not by the works of the law, since by the works of the law shall no flesh be justified. And that, in contrast to Romans 2:13, says that not the hearers of the law are just before God, but the doers of the law will be justified. Would you not agree that that appears to be a contradiction? But as I said, when we understand that the word, for the word law in the Greek, nomos, can be dealt with the same way we use our English word today, law, that it can have more than one meaning depending on the context, then we see that there is not a discrepancy. If I say today to someone who says I have to sign up as a political action committee to preach the gospel, if I say I don't have to obey that law, and then I turn around and say, I do have to obey that law, that is the law of God, I'm talking about two different things, but I have the same phrase. One says I do not have to obey the law, the other phrase says I do have to obey the law. You have to look at the context of both of those phrases. Well, let's look at the context of Romans chapter 2 again. The context can be seen, first of all, by looking at verse 1. He says, therefore, you are without excuse, every man of you who passes judgment. For in that you judge another, you condemn yourself, for you who judge practice the same thing. He was dealing here clearly with hypocrites. Now, going on in this particular chapter, down to verse 17, it says, but you bear the name Jew and rely upon the law and boast in God and know his will and approve the things that are essential being instructed out of the law and are confident that you yourselves are a guide to the blind, a light to those who are in darkness, a corrector of the foolish, a teacher of the immature, having in the law the embodiment of knowledge and of the truth. You therefore who teach another, do you not teach yourself? You who preach that one should not steal, do you steal? And here we see that God is dealing with some hypocritical people, Paul is anyway, and that he is showing that the divine law is in existence, and that that law we have to obey according to verse 13, we have to do it to be justified, but in their case, they were not doing that law because they were guilty of stealing and they were guilty of adultery. The bottom line is the law is good if it's used how? Lawfully, according to 1 Timothy. I showed in the last message that the Mosaic Law Covenant was added. Going back to Galatians chapter 3, again read verse 19. Why the law then? It was added because of transgressions, having been ordained through angels. That's dropping on down to verse 24. Therefore, the law has become our tutor to lead us to Christ, that we may be justified by faith. But now that faith has come, we are no longer under a tutor. And as we said in last week's message, something was added, and that was the law that Paul was talking about in Galatians 3. What was added? the Mosaic Law Covenant. Now, what I want to emphasize in this message is this, not so much at this point what was added, but the fact that it was added. Now, think about it. If it was added, then there was something already in existence. If I say I built an addition onto my house, we know that I didn't just build a house. I added an addition on that house. If I say 1 + 2 = 3, we know that 3 came as a result of adding 2. And this was added to what? God's law. Does that make sense? The Mosaic Law Covenant was added to the divine law. They hooked up together, and what did they call this at Paul's time? The word law can refer more than one thing. They called it the law. And they were referring to the Mosaic Law Covenant that encompassed the things that God added to the divine law. It included the divine law and the Mosaic Law Covenant, which had sacrificial laws and ceremonial laws also. And the deal was, you do this and you'll be my people and I'll be your God. And they said, it's a deal, we'll do it. But the requirement was they had to do all of it. The Mosaic Law Covenant was added 430 years after Abraham. And I just run a little line down here from Abraham. The Law Covenant added at that time. It was a schoolmaster to lead us to Christ. It was added because of our transgressions. And according to Hebrews chapter 9, we'll just write that in there, Hebrews 9:15, right here, it ended at the time of the cross. Let's read Hebrews 9:15. And for this reason, he is the mediator of a new covenant, in order that since a death has taken place for the redemption of the transgressions that were committed under the first covenant, those who have been called may receive the promise of the eternal inheritance. For where a covenant is, there must of necessity be the death of the one who made it. For a covenant is valid only when men are dead, for it is never in force while the one who made it lives. Therefore, even the first covenant, talking about the Mosaic Law Covenant, was not inaugurated without blood. For when every commandment had been spoken by Moses to all the people according to the law, he took the blood of the calves and of the goats with water and scarlet wool and hyssop, and sprinkled both the book itself and all the people, saying, "This is the blood of the covenant which God commanded you." And in the same way he sprinkled both the tabernacle and all the vessels of the ministry with the blood. And according to the law, one may almost say, all things are cleansed with blood, and without shedding of blood there is no forgiveness. Therefore it was necessary for the copies of the things in the heavens to be cleansed with these, but the heavenly things themselves with better sacrifices than these. For Christ did not enter a holy place made with hands, a mere copy of the true one, but into heaven itself, now to appear in the presence of God for us. Nor was it that he should offer himself often, as the high priest enters the holy place year by year with blood not of their own. Otherwise he would have needed to suffer often since the foundation of the world. But now, once at the consummation of the ages, he has been manifested to put away sin by the sacrifice of himself. And inasmuch as it is appointed for men to die once, and after this comes judgment, so Christ also, having been offered once to bear the sins of many, shall appear a second time for salvation without reference to sin to those who eagerly await him. For the law, since it has only a shadow of the good things to come and not the very form of things, can never by the same sacrifices year by year which they offer continually make perfect those who draw near. We're going to stop there, and let's think about that last scripture. He said the law, which was only a shadow. This Mosaic Law Covenant was just a shadow of what? Of the things to come. It was the schoolmaster, the tutor, if you will, that was going to lead us to Christ. Notice that I made the box around the Mosaic Law Covenant somewhat open-ended. When did the Mosaic Law covenant end as far as God was concerned? When? At the cross, when Christ died. But as far as the world was concerned, because of the efforts of Judaizers, it would appear that that Mosaic Law covenant was continuing for a time. And that's why I put the dotted line coming out here a ways. And I want to put a scripture over here, and that would be Hebrews chapter 8, verse 13. Why do I put it there? Because that verse says, when he set a new covenant, he has made the first obsolete. He was making this covenant obsolete, the Mosaic Law covenant. But whatever is becoming obsolete and growing old is ready to disappear. Now, when was Hebrews chapter 8, verse 13 written? After the cross. And what was happening to it? It was growing old. That's why we've dotted the line out. And it was what? Disappearing. But in this time frame here, before it disappeared, there were problems developing, and that's what Paul was addressing when he was talking about the law, that you can't be justified by keeping it. He was talking about the Mosaic Law covenant. By the way, if we have an equation here, x plus 2 equals 3. And another equation, it says 3 minus 2 equals x. Then what does x equal? Jim, you can handle it. Get your calculator out. It equals 1. And this is sort of the way I'd like to relate it here, is if you think of the law as 1, then in the Mosaic dispensation, that law, number 1, still existed, but God added the second thing, the Mosaic Law covenant, so that we have 3 down here. Then we are told that it was taken out of the way at the time of the cross. That would be minus 2. What's that leave us up with? Still 1. The point is, God's law, the divine law, existed all the way through patriarchal dispensation, the Mosaic dispensation, and the Christian dispensation. True, he added something to it, but when he took that something away, we still have what we had to begin with, which was the law. Does that make sense? Okay, to understand what would appear to be a contradiction of Paul's writings then, we must understand the Mosaic Law covenant that was added in relation to a word called justification. The word justification means to render innocent, to justify, to pronounce righteous, to be acquitted. Now, how was Abraham over here in the patriarchal dispensation, how was he justified? By faith. We'll not turn and look at the scriptures. I think we looked at those in the last message, but you can check them out yourself. That's Romans 4, 1 through 3, and Genesis 15, verse 6. Abraham was justified by faith. Now, what we need to see here then is in relation to justification, in this patriarchal dispensation, Abraham was justified by faith. All right? Now, in regards to justification, how were the people in the Mosaic dispensation justified? Turn to Deuteronomy chapter 6, and we'll read verse 25. And it will be righteousness for us if we are careful to observe all this commandment before the Lord our God, just as he commanded us. So, in this dispensation then, we find that they were justified by obeying all the commandments. And that's called works of the law. That would be the Mosaic Law covenant, the whole works. Deuteronomy 6:25. Now, that's a key point. Go back to Galatians chapter 3 and notice with me verse 12. However, the law is not of faith. On the contrary, he who practices them shall live by them. Look at verse 10. For as many as are the works of the law are under a curse. For it is written, cursed is everyone who does not abide by all things written in the book of the law to perform them. So here we see in verse 12 that the law, and that I've already identified the law that Paul's talking about in Galatians 3 as a Mosaic law covenant. He said the law then was not of what? It was not of faith. On the contrary, what was it then? If it was not of faith, it was the works of the law. But the problem was they were under a curse because they had to keep all the law and they didn't do it. And now that's why God instituted the sacrificial and ceremonial laws. The sacrifices they offered was a rolling ahead of their sins, and they anticipated a coming Messiah that would take care of their problem. In this dispensation here, how are we justified? Well, look at Galatians chapter 3, verse 24 and 25. Therefore, the law has become our tutor to lead us to Christ, that we may be justified by what? By faith. So now we go back to the justification aspect of the dispensations. They are justified in this dispensation, according to Scripture, by faith. Let's turn to Romans chapter 3 again, verse 28. For we maintain that a man is justified by faith apart from works of the law. Now that would seem in contradiction to Romans 2 verse 13, which says, for not the hearers of the law are justified before God, but the doers of the law will be justified. The contradiction ceases to exist when we recognize that what he was talking about, and you can see it in what we've shown so far, is that they could not be justified by keeping this law, that is the Mosaic law covenant. This is a big problem in Paul's day. Why? Because there were Judaizers that were coming around, and they were saying to the Christians, or the men that were becoming Christians from the other nations, the Gentiles, they were saying in order to be justified and have salvation, they had to keep that which was added. That's what Paul's addressing, and they had to keep that which was added, else they would not be justified, they would not be saved. And the problem revolved around the issue of Judaization. The adding of the Mosaic law covenant into the Christian dispensation, the adding back of that which God had already taken out of the way, and saying you must do this to be saved, to be justified in right standing with God. Now here's a case in point. And if you think about it, if you were a Christian back then, one of these men from the other nations that became a Christian, and one day in the men's room, a fella said to you, hey, you're not right with God. What are you talking about? Well, Paul talked about men that came in and spied out their privacy. What am I talking about? Circumcision. Now, that was a big issue that Paul dealt with. That was not the only issue of Mosaic law covenant, but that's one that the Bible seems to bring out rather clearly. Now, circumcision came into existence right here at the time of Abraham. God's divine law existed even before then, right? And at that point in time, God gave circumcision to the household of Abraham because of a covenant that he made with Abraham. But think of it this way. 430 years later, God gave circumcision to a nation as means of justification, or as one of the many means of justification. Circumcision here, as far as I can see, was not for justification purposes. Abraham was justified by what? Faith. But justification over here required that they keep all of what Moses said. They said, we'll do all that you say. Well, he brought to them the divine law, but he also brought to them these ceremonial laws, which included circumcision. So I want to write that down here. There are certain things here then that came with ceremonial law. One of them was circumcision. And you can just start adding them on down. What else came? We talked about last week. The priesthood. What else?
Sacrifices.
Yeah, the sacrifices up here. How about the temple? And we'll go on down here in a minute. Okay, circumcision then. That was added as a means of justification 430 years after Abraham. And there were certain men coming around saying that you have got to be circumcised. Turn to Acts chapter 15. Acts 15 verse 1. And some men came down from Judea. What kind of men, you suppose? Judaizers. And began teaching the brethren, unless you are circumcised according to the custom of Moses, you cannot be saved. Now that was just an example of the problem that that Paul was having. The old Mosaic law covenant ended as far as God was concerned at the cross. But as far as men were concerned, certain Judaizers, it continued on. Paul said it's fading away, it's coming to an end. But in that transition period, you had these men running around saying, you have to be circumcised. Now, let's turn to Galatians chapter 4. Look at verse 21 with me. Tell me, you who want to be under the law, do you not listen to the law? For it is written that Abraham had two sons, one by the bondwoman and one by the free woman. But the son of the bondwoman was born according to the flesh, and the son of the free woman according to the promises. This is allegorically speaking, for these women are two covenants, one proceeding from Mount Sinai, bearing children who are to be slaves. She is Hagar. Now this Hagar is Mount Sinai in Arabia, and corresponds to the present Jerusalem, for she is in slavery with her children. But the Jerusalem above is free. She is our mother, for it is written, rejoice, barren woman who does not bear. Break forth and shout, you who are in labor, for more are the children of the desolate than of the one who has a husband. And you, brethren, like Isaac, are children of promise. But as at that time he who was born according to the flesh persecuted him who was born according to the Spirit, so it is now also. But what does the Scripture say? Cast out the bondwoman and her son, for the son of the bondwoman shall not be an heir with the son of the free woman. So then, brethren, we are not children of a bondwoman, but of the free woman. It was for freedom that Christ set us free. Therefore, keep standing firm, and do not be subject again to a yoke of slavery. Behold, I, Paul, say to you, that if you receive circumcision, Christ will be of no benefit to you. And I testify again to every man who receives circumcision, that he is under obligation to keep the whole law. You have been severed from Christ, you who are seeking to be justified by law. You have fallen from grace. Now, Christians have taken and say, hey, I have been set free by Christ. I'm no longer under God's law. But when they say it, they're referring to the divine law. If you look at the context, Paul was obviously referring to the Mosaic law covenant, those things that were added 430 years later, including which was circumcision for justification. And he gets pretty serious here. He says, look, if you're trying to implement and maintain that we've got to keep these things, such as circumcision, you are being severed from Christ. And he gives the two covenants. How many are with me so far? Good. Let the record show that everyone in this church, very intelligent people, and they understand. Look at 1 Corinthians chapter 7, verse 17. Only as the Lord has assigned to each one, as God has called each, in this manner let him walk. And thus I direct in all the churches, was any man called already circumcised? Let him not become uncircumcised. Has anyone been called in uncircumcision? Let him not be circumcised. Circumcision is nothing, and uncircumcision is nothing. But what matters is the keeping of the commandments of God. Now, what are the commandments of God? the divine law. That matters. But he's trying to say these other things, they don't matter. I talked to a gentleman last week, right out over here by the door. We're addressing circumcision a little bit. And he said, well, I wanted my boy to be circumcised because I didn't want him to be cut off from God. And I said, hold it right there. If you have the idea that circumcision or non-circumcision has something to do with whether or not you're cut off from God, you are a Judaizer. Now, I'm not saying that circumcision shouldn't exist today. It's interesting to note that most of Abraham's descendants still have their children circumcised. But I'm telling you this, don't you dare teach anyone they have to be circumcised in order to be in right standing with Christ and God Almighty. Does that make sense? Bondage and slavery and a curse was all part of trying to keep that which had been added. He said, the first covenant, that was the bondwoman. The other one represented the free woman. Well, why was it bondage? Because they were bound to keep the entire law. It was a curse because they could not keep all of it. Turn over to Romans chapter 10, verse 4. It says, for Christ is the end of the law for righteousness to everyone who believes. What does he mean that he's the end of the law for righteousness? What law? This law right here. Sacrificial laws, did they end? Yes. Now, technically, to make it more accurate, they really continue on. How do they continue on? Well, today, according to Hebrews 9:26, Christ is our sacrifice. So I don't think I'll write all this out. It'll be on the chart when I send it out on the tape. Hebrews 9:26, He was our sacrifice. How about the ceremonial laws, such as circumcision? Well, according to Colossians 2:11, again, we're circumcised how? Through Jesus Christ. That would be this one right here. How about the priesthood? Who is our high priest today? You see, it ended in a sort. Actually, it continued on in a different form. What did we read earlier? This was a shadow of what was coming. All right, how about the temple? Who's the temple today? We are. How about the tabernacle? Did we not read that Christ entered in a more perfect tabernacle? These were all just shadows of things to come. Ceremonial law, circumcision, priesthood, the temple, the tabernacle, and that type of thing. The nature of the Judaizers were that they were very concerned that you keep certain parts of this old Mosaic law covenant, but they really weren't that concerned about the divine law. Paul says, you guys are guilty of adultery. You guys are guilty of stealing. But boy, they were death on this type of stuff. Turn to Galatians chapter 6, verse 12. Those who desire to make a good showing in the flesh try to compel you to be circumcised simply that they may not be persecuted for the cross of Christ. For those who are circumcised do not even keep the law themselves, but they desire to have you circumcised that they may boast in your flesh. May it never be that I should boast except in the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom the world has been crucified to me and I to the world. For neither is circumcision anything nor uncircumcision, but a new creation. These people, these Judaizers, were so concerned about these things, but they really weren't that concerned about this. And guess who they really were concerned about obeying? Caesar. They're the same people that today says, you must be brothers and sisters of Israel in accordance with Romans 13. In authority, godly authority, you must submit to authority. And the state is that authority, blah, 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 you see. Well, Romans 13 was talking about higher powers, not lower powers. It's like the old Baptist preacher says, not the higher powers that give me trouble, it's these lower powers. But the point is that we have Judaizers today that are so concerned that you keep certain aspects of this Mosaic law covenant, and then they turn right around. They're not interested about God's divine law being obeyed by Caesar. You see, that law was not only for us, but for Caesar too, right? They're concerned that you be in submission to the authorities, to the higher powers, and they misteach Romans 13, And it's interesting to me, though, although they're not concerned about our society following God's divine law all that much, as they are teaching you in submission to be in submission to Caesar, but they're really concerned about these different things, the ceremonial law. One of them being, I left that off to the last, feast days. You study out your own Bible. Don't get angry at me, because I'm not saying this to make anybody angry. But you find, and then you show me from the Bible, where the feast days ever existed before the Mosaic Law Covenant. Did Abraham keep the feast of Passover? It came into existence when they were coming out of Egypt. Now, people will say, well, I can show you that certain things were done on these certain dates. And I do believe that God's got a miraculous calendar, and that our sovereign God's got everything working right according to his clockwork. But as far as the requirement to keep the feast days, that was a requirement under the Mosaic Law Covenant. Now, here's a letter that someone sent to me. Listen to it. They didn't sign it. Actually, I guess I have to assume it's from God, because they wrote it like it came from God, but I don't think that's God's typewriter. It says, Pete Peters, why? Why is it you continue to refuse to obey me, King of Israel, whom you claim to serve? Why do you continue to stay in rebellion against me? Rebellion is as the sin of witchcraft, and covetousness is as idolatry. Your sins magnify up to heaven while you pride yourself in keeping my law. And this is your next continuing idolatry, for you covet your own ways and your own meetings. Pete Peters Camp Meeting, April 13th through 16th, 1990. You're right in one thing, it is your camp meeting. But I won't be there. I will be with my people who are honoring me by keeping Passover after sunset on April 9th and keeping the Feast of Unleavened Bread, April 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 19, 90. Going down, he says, my camp meetings are not part of this world and are not called camp meetings. Mine are called feast days or festivals, holy days. And they that honor me will honor my holy times. You have never read the first two verses of Leviticus 23. These are my feasts. They are not Jewish. Now stop being a stiff-necked Israelite, for you are uncircumcised in heart, not honoring me at the time I command you. Now is your time to repent, Pete, and all those with you. Now, the person that wrote that letter, do you get, as I do, the distinct feeling that he believes that a certain measure of justification comes from keeping the feasts? Or is that my imagination? Do you not see that he feels that I am not justified? I am not in good standing with God because I'm not keeping these holy days. Well, now, I don't think that that person wrote the letter because they dislike me. I would bet, if I had to bet one way or the other, that person probably is writing it out of love and concern for me. And I appreciate that. And I only hope that the people that hear this will appreciate the fact that I'm saying this out of love and concern for those who are trying to bind aspects of the Mosaic Law Covenant into the New Testament Christian dispensation. You are severing yourself from Christ if you're seeking to be justified by the law, the Mosaic Law Covenant. Isn't that what he said in Galatians 5? You're severed from Christ. It's one way or the other. I acknowledge that. If I say you don't have to keep these in order to be justified with Christ, and someone else says you do have to keep these to be justified, one or the other is damned. According to Galatians 5, 1 through 3. You read it. I don't want to mislead you. You better check it out. What I'm trying to show, and I've tried to show in these last two messages, is what Paul was talking about. That Mosaic Law Covenant. That's why he spent so much time talking about not being under the law. The Mosaic Law Covenant of these things. Not being justified by keeping these, but by justified by faith. And at the same time, he was not talking about not keeping the commandments of God, which are contained in the divine law. And believe it or not, Judaization is growing enough, even amongst the Christian Israel identity movement, that in certain parts, I understand back towards the southeast, that sacrifices are being instituted. And let me say this without getting upset. I'll try to say it calmly. If you are taking and reinstituting these sacrificial laws, and they normally ride on the horse called feast days, that's the second thing that normally comes along. If you're trying to keep these sacrificial laws as if they're supposed to be kept in this Christian dispensation, you are one damned Christian. Galatians 5:1-3. Does that sound fair enough? You are severed from Christ, you who would be justified in keeping these things. Now, there are some saying, well, I don't think you have to do these things. I like to gather at that point in time. As far as I'm concerned, you can gather any day of the 12 months of the year. And where two or three are gathered in His name, there He is in the midst of them. But when you start teaching that you've got to do it because these are God's commandments and these are His requirements, if you want to be circumcised and you're not right now, then that's your choice. But if you begin to teach someone else that he has to be, you see, you're severing him from Christ. So the final analysis, God's divine law was during the patriarchal dispensation, during the Mosaic dispensation, at which time He added to it, and during the Christian dispensation, at which time He has taken away, replaced it with something different, Jesus Christ. Now I ask you, does that make sense? Let's stand. Our Father in heaven, I ask that you would guide and lead us in truth and understanding. I pray that you would direct us so that we would not mislead anyone, that we'd have a proper understanding concerning this thing of the law. We know that our country is in shambles. The sins of adultery, homosexuality, economic sins, agricultural sins, violations of your law in every aspect. This being done because it's taught that it's no longer in existence. Help us, Father, to get a clear understanding of what was being taught in Scripture. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. 'Twas grace that taught my heart to fear, and my fears relieved. How precious did that grace appear the hour I first believed. Through snares I have already come. 'Tis grace that brought me safe thus far, and grace will lead me home. When we've been there 10,000 years, bright shining as the sun, we know
Fire and smoke. I looked around me and looked so fine. I asked my Lord if all this was mine. Every time I feel a spirit moving in my heart, I will pray. Every time I feel a spirit moving in my heart, I will pray. There ain't but one train running on this track. It runs to heaven and it runs right back. If I behave, they will let me ride.